Hey guys, let's make a 360 photo in 4 minutes with an Android phone in the year 2020. And right now I'm going to share my 360 workflow with my OnePlus 7 Pro. I'll tell you how to view, edit, and share 360 photos using this method. I use the app Touch Retouch, a Google Camera APK, the Snapseed app, Street View app, and the Theta Plus app. What I'm doing here is I'm starting and I'm going in a circle in the first row of photos. And what I do here is I firmly plant my right foot and I pivot and I move to the left. When I go to the next row, I do the same thing, and I personally like to move to the left because that's what comes most naturally to me. I learned this by playing basketball. So pick a foot, pivot, and just go around the center. This helps ensure that you hit that no parallax point so that everything stitches together really well. I'm using a OnePlus 7 Pro to create this photo that ends up with a resolution of 8,704 by 4,352 pixels, which is pretty decent. It's not the best. I'd like to get up to the 10,000 point, but this is really doing a good job. When you finish, it starts to export the file. I give it a few moments just to make sure it finishes up before I move on to editing. I go ahead and go into the Touch Retouch app to go ahead and look for any stitching errors that I can fix. Usually there is about one or two or three that you can see in the background, but as long as you're not close up to any close nearby objects, it's usually no problem. I go ahead and get rid of my shadow here, and Touch Retouch does a really great job of recognizing that using that tool. And I just kind of zoom around looking for anything that looks out of the ordinary. That was my bike there, which I drove over there, and it's kind of big and has a shadow, so I just choose to leave it because I don't think that Touch Retouch would do a real good job with removing it because there's so much detail there surrounding the bike, and it really doesn't distract from the overall image. Down here below, you'll see that there is a little picture of what appears to be part of my shoe, and so just get rid of that, and I look all around just looking for anything that doesn't look quite right. And we save it, export it, and then we go into the next application we'll be using, which is Google Snapseed. This one is great for bringing out the colors and the HDR. I really like to use the accentuate option because it just makes it come to life really easily. It's quick. We go ahead and we export that, and literally we are almost at 3 minutes, and I've created an image that is going to be loaded onto Google Street View, and that's what I'm doing right now. We go ahead and load it into that Street View app. Once it's loaded, I add it to a maps listing. This particular image was taken at a pond, and I want to add it to the city that I'm located in Minot, North Dakota, since there's no nearby landmark that I can add it to or list it to. Right now we just zoom around, kind of take a look and see if that looks geographically correct. And it is fairly accurate. So select on that and we go ahead and hit upload. And now this is being uploaded to Google Street View as well as Google Maps. So I really enjoy making 360 photos using my phone. It's quick, it's easy. I used to use a tripod and a mount to try to collect really, really high quality 360 photos. And I just found that the algorithms are so good with the Google Camera app that with good technique, with pivoting on that one foot, and turning really quickly, that it's really unnecessary to bring a tripod along with you when you're taking photos that are out in the open and in a park or nearby a pond. As long as you're not nearby a really close object, you have no issue usually with stitching errors or with parallax problems. So here's a quick tour of what this image looks like when it's opened in the Ricoh Theta Plus application, which is my preferred method of scrolling around and taking a look at an image. You'll notice that there are very few stitching errors. You can see one there in the green, but way off in the distance. Light poles and telephone lines are really good at making stitching errors. They show up pretty easily, but again, it's in the background. It's really hard to see, and it's not noticeable to most people. If you are really into 360 photography, your eye is going to catch it, but the average person is just going to look at that and not even notice it, really. So we zoom around. The color's really nice. It pops, and the sky is really, really beautiful. It has a deep color blue. I started taking photos with a tripod and mount with my phone. I then moved on to a GoPro Hero 3 with a 3D printed pano head I tried the GoPro Fusion, and now I use a Nikon D610 with a Nodal Ninja for my professional 360 virtual tours. I seem to always come back to using my phone when I'm on the go or I'm just taking a 360 photo for fun, especially if I just want to make a tiny planet and post it on Instagram. The Ricoh Theta Plus app is free to use even if you don't have a Ricoh camera, and it does amazing work. It is really useful for making tiny planets. It is really simple to select on the tiny planet area and then move your finger around until you get it to the right orientation. And then what I do is I take and I put it back into Snapseed in order to crop it into a nice square to be posted on Instagram. Before I go, I wanted to share a few tips for taking a really good 360 photo with your phone using the Google Photosphere. The key things here is positioning and your mechanics as you turn around in the photo. I recommend keeping your elbows pressed against your body to act as a natural stabilizer that will allow you to move from dot to dot in a really efficient way. The top of the camera should rest up at the top of your forehead, kind of like if you were a pitcher in baseball holding your hands up for the windup. You want to pick a position and keep it there so that it's level and even throughout the entire image collection process. You want to aim for about a 45 degree angle when you're taking the top and bottom rows, and you want to try to maintain that. So however you rotate your wrists inward or downward, you want to try to maintain that throughout the entire photo taking process. The more things that you can keep the same, the better the results will be on the latter end of this photo creation process. I also recommend that you don't go too slow or too fast as you're moving from dot to dot. It takes time to get familiar with this, but once you get the hang of it, you can really move around and take a photo fairly quickly. As you saw, it took me only 4 minutes to take a photo, edit it, and post it to Google Street View. You could also post this photo to Facebook, and it'll show up in your newsfeed really well. I like to share these photos with my friends and post them as tiny planets on Instagram. If you go too fast or too slow, I found that it creates spatial orientation errors. I recommend moving swiftly between dots and then slowing down just as you reach the middle of the dot and pause. That way it moves quickly, and I've had the best success that way. I'm not really sure why the Google algorithm gets confused when you go too slow or too fast. Maybe you guys have an answer and you can leave it in the comment section below and explain what is happening in the Google Photosphere. I do think that the software has improved over the time that I've been using it. I started taking photos with my OnePlus 7 Pro about a year ago, and as this camera APK has updated, I found that it takes better and better photos as time goes along. Would you guys consider taking a 360 photo with your smartphone? Let me know down in the comment section below. Check out the description of this video for links to all of the apps that I used and other helpful information. If you like this video or you learned something new, please give it a thumbs up, and we'll see you in the next one.